Hi everyone, in today's video, we will discuss how our brain processes emotions. Now the content of this video is primarily sourced from Dr. Faith Harper's best-selling book, Unfuck Your Brain. In addition, I've also referred to a few articles and I have linked them all in the description below. And now let's get on with the video. You know, we often separate out our mental health and physical health. We think that any discussion around brain health belongs to the physical health category, and emotions, feelings, and behavior in general belong to the mental health category. But in reality, our bodies affect each other through a continuous feedback loop. You know, our emotions and brain are inextricably combined. And this is something I also referred in my recent video on the four body model system. Now think about why we call our gut our second brain. That's because the feelings that arise in the gut directly influence our decision-making process. And so we can say that our mind is not just something that's localized in our head, but it's actually situated deep inside our body. And so any thought, emotion, feeling we have is colored not only by how our brain is perceiving the world, but it's also colored through past experiences and the current information we have about things. Now, if I were to put all these parameters in an equation, it would look something like this. Thoughts plus feelings plus behaviors equals your brain functioning plus your past experiences plus your current information. And so if you want to uncover why you respond the way you do, or why you have certain emotional responses, then you must understand how your brain functions, how it works, and really what's going on inside it. Because once you get that part, you will have so much more compassion for yourself about the way you respond, and that often gives us the courage to change. Now, with this as baseline, let's deep dive into the working of the emotional brain. Now, a simple model through which to understand the brain is the Triune Brain Model. And it divides brain into three parts, reptilian brain, middle brain, and new brain. Now, this is the image of the brain that we usually see. And according to this model, we have three separate brains inside our brain. Now, each brain, as you can imagine, performs a different function. The first one to develop is the reptilian brain, and it is the most primitive brain, and its main job is to keep you alive, hence also called the survival brain. And this is the brain that's responsible for your fight, flight, or freeze response. Next to develop is the middle brain, and this is the part of the brain that processes your emotions. You can also think of it as your emotions headquarter. And finally, the new brain is the last one to develop, and it's primarily responsible for your thinking and reasoning skills. As you can imagine, these three brains interconnect with one another. Now, in this video, because we are primarily focusing on how the emotional brain works, so we limit our discussion to only those parts of the brain that play a direct role in emotional processing. So starting with the new brain, the part that plays an integral and important role in helping us process our emotions is this frontal part. This is also called the prefrontal cortex. We will call it PFC for short. Now, it is in charge of the executive functioning, meaning it helps you problem solve, helps you make decisions that are aligned with your goals, and it even helps you manage your social interactions. Now, your PFC takes in information from the outside and manages your thoughts and actions accordingly. And it's highly connected with the rest of the brain. So you can think of your PFC like a CEO of a company. Now, this part of the brain, your PFC, it keeps growing until you're in your mid-20s. And as you get older, your brain creates new and complex wiring with all the information you have learned, you have accumulated. And technically, as you age, your PFC's working should improve. Now, on paper, theoretically speaking, this is the brain that's truly in charge. Now, there are two key parts of the PFC that connect with your middle brain, with the emotional brain. The first part is the backside of the PFC. This is directly linked with the emotional brain. So think of it as a part of the brain that allows an easy two-way communication between the thinking brain and the emotional brain. The next part is called the anterior cingulate cortex. We will call it ACC for short. Now this part acts as a middleman between your PFC and your emotional brain. So it manages the conversation between how you think and how you feel, and then it makes a suggestion on what you should do about it. Now the interesting part is that the neural wiring in ACC is actually quite different from the rest of the brain. Whereas the neurons in the rest of the brain are short and bushy, kind of like a sumo wrestler, the neurons in ACC are tall and slender. Think Victoria's Secret supermodels. And so if you're wondering what's the big deal, well, the big deal is that the neurons in ACC send signals way faster than the rest of the neurons, than the rest of the brain. And so when you get hit with an instant emotional response, this is why. So far we have talked about PFC, we have talked about two key parts of PFC that directly connect with the emotional brain. So moving along to the middle brain, this is the part of the brain that's responsible for your emotions. It's also called your limbic brain or your emotions headquarter. And here we will focus on two key parts of the limbic system, amygdala and the hippocampus. Now the main job of the amygdala, and we have two of them on either side of the brain, its main job is to relate memories to emotions. What does that mean? It means that your amygdala is only interested in memories where you had a big emotional response. Like it doesn't care about what you had for lunch or how many books you read or how many miles you ran because there's no big emotion attached to it. It's kind of looking for the juicy stuff, kind of like when you had your first kiss or your first plane ride or you got your heart broken or you bought your first house and had a child. You know, basically memories with lots of emotions attached to it. Now these memories could be sad, happy, or outrightly depressive. Your amygdala doesn't care. Anytime you have heightened emotion, it lights up. Now these highly charged memories, they are called episodic autobiographical memories, or EAM for short. Episodic means pertaining to a specific episode or a key episode in your life. Autobiographical meaning, what was your experience? What meaning did you give to that event? What emotion came up for you? Kind of like things you would write in a journal after a good or not so good experience. Those are the things we are going for here. So these EAM memories are cataloged by your amygdala and then they are put in the storage. A simple analogy here is think of how books are cataloged in a library. So there's a similar process going on in your limbic brain. Now the place where the amygdala stores these memories, it's called hippocampus. And what gets stored on these EAM files is the event, as in what happened, plus your emotional response, plus your interpretation of the event, as in the meaning you gave to that event. So let's create a few EAM files, and the process is quite similar to CPU processing. So EAM file number one, this is about the time you took your first plane ride. Your emotional response was you felt ecstatic, and the interpretation you gave to this event was, I love flying, I love traveling, and when I grow up, I'm going to travel the world. EAM file number two, this was a time when you had your first kiss, and you felt deliriously happy, and the interpretation you gave to this event was, oh my God, I love my person. EAM file number three, let's say this was the time when you got your heart broken at a popular coffee shop, and your emotional response was, you felt sad, miserable, even depressed, and perhaps you interpreted this event as, I'm never going to ask out anyone again, or I'm never going to have coffee from that coffee shop again, or something similar. EAM file number four, let's say this is the time you got mugged and your emotional response became, the world is not a safe place, I am not safe. And maybe the interpretation you gave this event was, I won't step out of the house after dark, or you might interpret it as, I'm just unlucky, or I need to join martial arts classes, or something similar. So you get the gist. Now the thing to remember is that the good memories are obviously not the issue, but the troubled ones are. Because if something really significant happened to you in your life, like a divorce or abuse or trauma event, then whatever dominant emotion you had at that time, it becomes attached to that memory like cat hair, like static cling. So imagine anytime you remember the good memories, that's awesome, right? But the bad ones, that sucks, and it sucks big time. And what I really want to bring your attention to is this. When you have, say, a negative emotional response in the present, chances are your amygdala opened an EM file and it matched whatever you are experiencing in this now moment based on a past memory. In other words, your amygdala identified a threat, again, based on the past memory, even though there may be zero threat in this now, in this current moment. So let's elaborate what we have just discussed with an example. So say your boyfriend proposed to you with flowers. Now flowers make you happy, and let's say this EAM file reads, I was proposed, I feel on top of the world, and maybe you interpreted this event as, flowers always bring a smile on my face, I love flowers because that's how I got proposed. And so the overall emotional charge connected with this memory is nice feelings, happy feelings. But say you got flowers when a loved one died unexpectedly. Maybe your friend thought it might be a good way to comfort you. And so now even the smell of flowers makes you feel uneasy, it makes you feel nauseated. And so your amygdala took this memory, this event, and it created another EAM file, which is loved one died unexpectedly. I am shocked, devastated. And maybe the interpretation you gave to this event was life is unpredictable. And oh, I got flowers and now they make me feel uneasy. Now the overall emotional charge connected with this memory is bad feelings, sad feelings. And at a physical level, visceral level, you feel nauseated whenever you smell flowers. Now fast forward, say you are at a farmer's market and you see flowers and you smell flowers. Next thing you know, you start losing your mind, not even know why, because what's happening is that in the current moment, while you are at farmer's market, your brain is back at your loved one's funeral, because your brain is now equating flowers with death. Now moving along to the reptilian brain, which also plays an integral part in processing emotions. Now first of all, it lies at the base of the brain and hence called brainstem, just like flowers have a flower stem. And this is the part of the brain that connects your spinal cord with the brain. And so it can instantly move you into action. Now your reptilian brain, like we discussed before, it's your fundamental survival tool. Its job is to keep you alive. That means its key function is being alert, conscious, staying aware of surroundings at all time. And this is the part of the brain that also regulates your breathing, breathing in and out, and keeps your heart pumping at all time, all day long. Now, when the brain stem senses danger, it will ramp up your heart rate, it will ramp up your breathing, and it will flood your PFC with neurochemicals such that your behavior turns into fight, flight, or freeze. In the fight mode, you are ready to kick someone's ass, you are ready to stand your ground. Think of Bruce Lee mode activated. In flight mode, you want to get the hell out of the situation, you want to run away as fast as you possibly can. Think of Bruce Jenner mode activated. In the freeze mode, you play possum and don't respond, hoping the situation would disappear on its own. Think possum mode activated. Now your fight, flight, and freeze is your survival response. This is your 911, your emergency broadcast system, and you want the system to be working effectively, especially when there is some real threat in the surrounding. For example, there's a fire in the house. You don't want to be sitting there thinking, oh, should I run or not? That's the time to run. Now, the moment this emergency alarm goes off, your ability to think rationally goes out the window. In other words, your PFC is no longer in charge because your amygdala has hijacked it. Now, the sad part is that this emergency broadcast system, it also starts beeping when there is no real threat in your immediate surrounding. Now, there are so many things that can appear threatening to your brain, like a final exam or speaking at a public event or even a deadline at work. So the first step in gaining control of our mind is that we have to stop this amygdala hijack. That means we have to put PFC back in charge. And how do we do that? Through stimulus discernment, which basically means teaching your brain to decide if something is a real danger or not. And this is primarily a thinking phenomena and not an emotional one. You know, we have to retrain our brain as to how things are in this now moment, not how they were 2 years back or 5 years back or even 10 years back. Because most of our emotional responses, our knee-jerk reactions, are coming from past traumatic events. So we have to convince our brain that in this now moment, you are safe. That's how you bring PFC back in charge and you teach your brain to override negative triggers. So a quick recap of what we have discussed so far. Your PFC takes in the outside information. This could be any event. Then the limbic brain gets involved. The amygdala receives the information, flips through the index of all the EAM files, and literally looks for the worst option that got played out. And then it says, the last time it happened, it sucked and it hurt. And then it triggers the emergency alarm system. Now the PFC behavior changes into fight, flight, or freeze. And one of these three modes gets activated. Now this should tell you right away that anytime you find yourself feeling defensive and combative, or freaking out big time, or completely shut off and dissociated, this is your survival response in action. This is not the real you. So next time you find yourself in one of these three modes, see if you can remind yourself that this is part of your brain's emergency response system. This is based on some past memories, because this discernment alone, it will be a massive step forward in your emotional healing journey. I hope this video deepens your understanding of how the emotional brain works. As always, please only take what resonates, discard the rest. Thank you so much for your time, and I will see you in the next video.